Good evening to all of you this winter solstice, as we gather tonight for a service of comfort in the shadow of lament. Lamentation is an ancient spiritual practice by which we trust that the hopes and fears of all the years are met in God's grace. In a season both alive with beauty, but also drenched in weariness, grief, and loneliness for so many, we offer this sacred space as a balm for your soul. There's power in gathering as God's beloved community, as together we hold the promise of Emmanuel, God with us. As the carol sings, "And you beneath life's crushing load, whose forms are bending low, O rest beside the weary road, and hear the angels sing." Tonight we will receive stories that speak to the human experience and music that tends to the heart. I give thanks to Reverend Jason Carson Wilson and Sandy Sorensen for their reflections this evening, and to Andrew Hamilton, Dwan Reece, Nora Marsh, and Diane Brenneman for their music. Later in the service, we will invite you to participate in writing prayers, so I hope you are able to take one of these round discs of paper and a pen if you need one. We will also invite you to participate in the lighting of candles. Beloved community, let us now cross the threshold into sacred time with our centering song, "You May Remain Seated." It's found on page 116 of your hymnal.
Peace. Good evening. I invite you to join me in the candle lighting litany of remembrance. I'll be the one and you will be the many. Friends, in the Advent season, we light the candle of hope. Tonight, we light it for all who feel hopeless. Tonight, this light shines bright for prisoners, for the homeless, for patients with chronic illness, for individuals fighting to get out of debt, for refugees waiting for a safe place to rest, and for relationships that have no clear way forward. Tonight, we light this candle for the hopeless. In this season, we light the candle of peace. Tonight, we light this candle for all who thirst for peace. It shines bright for the anxious and unsettled, for those stalked by the violence of war, for any in seasons of transition or discernment, for all who struggle with mental health, and for people navigating rocky new beginnings. In this season, we light the candle of joy. Tonight, we light the candle of joy for all who need it. May this light shine for those who are overwhelmed, weary, and worn down. May this candle shine for those who need a good laugh, even in seasons of grief. In this season, we light the candle of love. Tonight, we light the candle of love for all who need it. May this light shine for loved ones lost, for love that has been betrayed, for love that has been neglected or forgotten, and for all who long for love and find themselves lonely. Thanks be to God.
Scripture reading is from chapter 3, verses 19 through 24. The thought of my affliction and my homelessness is wormwood and gall. My soul continually thinks of it and is bowed down within me. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in God.
Holding weariness and joy together has been this year's theme for me. My partner's cancer diagnosis, about which I kept silent for months because it wasn't mine to share, left me weary with worry. Overthinking, worrying, and creating scenarios are among my superpowers. Doing that without an outlet for my emotions nearly destroyed me. Sobbing in my living room at 3 a.m. to ensure Jim didn't hear me became a routine. Prolific posts and photos of our Cancun trip, filled with many fabulous moments, created a facade. We both spent the time driven by an insatiable need to live like this was our last week on earth. Leaving DC somehow felt like we'd left the cancer behind. We felt the same way as we headed to General Synod and the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries Holy Convocation. That weariness and fear ultimately left me struggling to use truly healthy coping mechanisms. Poor choices have impacted relationships and made a sacred space triggering, and PTSD has become a consequence of my actions. Unspoken remorse left me questioning my existence. That weariness only compounded my unspoken shame and fear as my partner began his treatment regimen. Watching him unable to move and not be able to not be the jovial person he is terrified me. But I told myself that I could only be silently terrified. Two trips to urgent care were necessary during the treatment journey. A conference with his son preceded the first trip with an update and announcement we might need to move up our June event. I went to the call like it was a job performance review. I left the call assured that they trusted me because I was already family. That first trip didn't yield a miraculous cure and no real explanation. So he struggled to move even as we Ubered to the north of Baltimore every day for 5 days for his chemotherapy. When chemo ended, we thought relief from the fatigue and pain would soon follow. It didn't. And a second urgent care trip became necessary. This time we finally learned the cause of his pain and fatigue. It wasn't the cancer or cancer treatment. He caught Lyme disease during a family reunion in North Carolina. That revelation eased some of my weariness. Shame for poor choices lingered and continues to linger, leaving me weary. Even if people choose to forgive me, I struggle to forgive myself. Knowing my partner and I made it through that journey made me seize and savor joy. Although I began immediately planning our June 22nd, 2024 wedding, following his proposal over margaritas at Mission in DuPont Circle after Dignity Washington Mass on June 11th, Pride Weekend, in case anybody was wondering, he was on board with uniting earlier than planned. So we marched down to the DC courthouse and got everything in order. Jim proved he was getting better when he decided it could be a surprise ceremony in our apartment. Some friends planned to either take us to dinner or order in. We agreed. One of the guests rode up in the elevator with Reverend Amanda and me. My suit and her collar didn't tip him off, and I said nothing for a change. He and Amanda entered our apartment and greeted friends who knew what was up. Meanwhile, I anxiously waited in the hallway for the three remaining friends. I was trying to will them to emerge from the elevator. They finally appeared at the end of the hallway, but were sauntering along. I encouraged them to hurry up, because after all, we needed to take care of something before dinner. As soon as they crossed the threshold, I welcomed them to our wedding. Once they got over the shock of being underdressed, I mean, they are gay men after all, two of them served as ring bearers, and one, a Catholic priest, blessed our union after Reverend Amanda officiated a beautiful ceremony during which, surprisingly, I cried. That was a joyous moment that rose out of such weariness. Joy was also gathering with two stepsons and their families at Thanksgiving. And another joy will be meeting my new bonus grandson, the first grandson in the family, and seeing my step-granddaughter. Weariness never really disappears, but moments of joy help you endure. That's the biggest lesson 2023 has taught me.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be. Let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be.
And when the broken-hearted people living in the world agree, there will be an answer, let it be. For though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they see, there will be an answer, let it be,
let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be, there will be an answer, let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be, now let it be, whisper to wisdom, let it be. And when the night is cloudy, there is still a light that shines on me, shine until tomorrow, let it be. I wake up to the sound of music. Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be. 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 Whisper words of wisdom. Let it be. Let it be. Let it be.
A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 1 through 5 and 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was in the beginning with God. All things were made through the Word, and without the Word was not anything made that was made. In the Word was life, and the life was the light of all. The light shines in the deepest night, and the night has not overcome it. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth.
For this evening's service, Amanda asked us to reflect on how a weary world rejoices. How do we hold both weariness and joy together? How can we be both and people? It has been a theme over our Advent season this year, one we've explored in worship and in nurtures. And the conversation has been powerful and rich and surprising and grace-filled. I have been grateful for the space. Holding the spaciousness of Advent and Christmas, this time of deep mystery, of waiting and hoping as the nights grow longer, is something I have found challenging in an either-or world, where things need to be in their proper place. I often feel like I'm being pulled along a furious trajectory of merriment and cheer and festivity. There is not much room for multiple, sometimes conflicting layers of emotion and realities. Oh, indeed, there is joy and love and delight and compassion and connection. There are cookies and lights and sparkling decorations and gatherings and song, and it is all wonderful. And there is pain and suffering and loss and sadness, loneliness and longing, despair and lament. The contradictions are too much for an either-or world that doesn't particularly wish to attend to the hard parts of the story, to that we cannot easily fix or reconcile or explain. Those places leave us so very vulnerable. Over the years, the losses compound. Families fall apart. We struggle with chronic illness and health challenges, both seen and unseen, like depression, one of my longtime companions on the journey. This year has been a year of much transition and loss and uncertainty for me. After 33 years as a staff person with the national setting of the United Church of Christ, I stepped away in faith that I would hear and discern the call of the next. The loss of identity and place has been challenging, spiritually disorienting, a wilderness place, even if a necessary one. And our own brokenness connects with the brokenness of our body's world, the horrific toll of war and conflict, poverty rooted in policy choices, a rise in hate violence, an accelerating climate crisis, and a global refugee crisis. All the more painfully ironic as we celebrate the story of a refugee family. In the midst of it all, I find great courage and hope in the words of Buddhist writer and activist Joanna Macy. Joanna Macy talks about the ways in which we have pathologized pain, made it a wrong thing, like a mistake, when it alerts us to what we need to be present with and pay attention to. She talks of the courage in speaking of our despair. Precisely because we speak it, she says, we don't stay there. Despair is the covering of our love for the world, and we crack it open by speaking it so that the love can act. She writes, "I'm not asking you to be hopeful all the time. That would be exhausting. The main thing is that you are fully present, showing up, and that you are ever finding your capacity to love this world, to be present with all of it, the joy and the weariness, living with elasticity of spirit, a both and faith. Last year, I stumbled upon what has become one of my favorite Christmas songs. It is called "There's Still My Joy" by the Indigo Girls. I want to close by reading the lyrics, which so beautifully express a both and faith. It's best experienced as a song, so when you get home, I would encourage you to check it out on YouTube. I won't inflict that on you. "There's Still My Joy." I took my tree down to the shore, the garland and the silver star, to find my peace and grieve no more, to heal this place inside my heart. On every branch, I laid some bread, and hungry birds filled up the sky. They rang like bells around my head. They sang my spirit back to life. The snow comes down on empty sand. There's tinsel moonlight on the waves. My soul was lost, but here I am. So this must be amazing grace. One tiny child can change the world. One shining light can show the way. Beyond my tears for all I've lost, there's still my joy. There's still my joy for Christmas Day. There's still my joy for Christmas Day.
Please feel free to sing along with any of the songs.
Frosty wind made moan. Earth stood hard as iron, water like a stone. Snow had fallen, snow on snow. In the bleak midwinter, long, long ago. Angels and archangels may have traveled there. Cherubim and seraphim thronged the air. But only his mother, when her maiden bliss, worshiped the
One of the most powerful experiences we can nurture is to pray for one another. You should have a paper moon on this winter solstice, and we invite you to write a prayer request on it. Perhaps it's something you're struggling with, a person in your life, or a troubling issue in the world today. We ask you not to use names, you'll understand why in a moment. As the music plays, write your anonymous prayer. And at the end of the song, we will come by to collect your prayers in a little basket. After the prayers have been collected, we'll invite you to come forward to light a candle in honor of a person or need in your life. And before returning to your seat, you'll be invited to draw the paper moon of someone else in this room to pray over in the coming weeks. We hope that you will find comfort knowing that someone in this room is praying for you while you pray for someone else. And for those joining us from home, please feel free to send your prayers to me by email. Reverend Sam and I will pray for you. So friends, let us pray together, writing our anonymous prayers as Andrew plays. So now we invite you to come forward, if you would like, to share the light from one of our Advent candles. Hope, peace, joy, or love, to kindle one of these votives. And you might light it for someone that you love, as a sign of hope in difficult times, as a prayer for peace where there is war, as a sign of your own inner light. You may light it for gratitude or joy. As you light the candle, you're welcome to speak a name, word, or phrase describing why you light it. As you come forward, remember you are not alone. Others come before you or go behind you. Together, our light grows. As you return, please draw a prayer from the basket to pray over in the coming week.
As we watch our light grow, I invite you to join me in sharing the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Before we depart from this sacred time together, I want to invite you to join us on Christmas Eve morning at 10:30 for a festive celebration of the final Sunday in Advent, as well as for our Christmas Eve candlelight service at 5:30 in the evening. Please feel free to reach out and invite any family or friends who might need the opportunity to experience God's love this Christmas. And now for our final blessing, I want to share with you Jan Richardson's blessing for the longest night. All throughout these months, as the shadows have lengthened, this blessing has been gathering itself, making ready, preparing for this night. It has practiced walking in the dark, traveling with its eyes closed, feeling its way by memory, by touch, by the pull of the moon, even as it wanes. So believe me when I tell you, this blessing will reach you, even if you have not light enough to read it. It will find you, even though you cannot see it coming. You will know the moment of its arriving by your release of the breath you have held so long, a loosening of the clenching in your hands, of the clutch around your heart, a thinning of the darkness that has drawn itself around you. This blessing does not mean to take the night away, but it knows its hidden roads, knows the resting spots along the path, knows what it means to travel in the company of a friend. So when this blessing comes, take its hand, get up, set out on the road you cannot see. This is the night when you can trust that any direction you go, you will be walking toward the dawn. Amen.